understand the night when she flashes her sparkling eyes at dusk. She flirts with twilight when the noise of day dies away.
I spent 2.5 hours on the freeway.
The night and twilight stay.
Then what choice do I have?
Stay, making
I've got to come to work.
Love.
There's plenty of other things I'd like to do with that 2.5 hours each day.
And the gentle twilight gives his light.
At the given time, I can't see any reprieve in the level of consumption of families. Although we have seen that in some other cultures, like in France, where they've specified a 35-hour working week, and that it is illegal to do anything but that. Here in Australia, we still see contracts signed that say 37.5 hours, so that the employee is not entitled to any extra day RDOs or whatever it might be classified as. They're signing those contracts for 37.5 hours, yet the implicit expectation is at least 50.
Talk of lovers through the ages.
Well, my crystal world, as you could call it, came crashing down about the age of 8. So that's where a bit of a reality check. My parents divorced. They didn't get along too well, and it was a long time coming. And it was quite obvious the way they treated each other and that. But Dad moved off of a... moved out with another lady, and I found it really difficult. Getting along with my mum and two sisters, because they were also dealing with the same sort of stuff I was going through. I found myself playing up a lot, throwing tantrums. I was a really tough kid to deal with, really. I just started hanging around the wrong kids, just getting in the crowds that started to drink a lot.
Interesting that a lot of the messages of why the mother's working are not coming from decisions that the family's made about whether or not it's more valuable for her to be out of the house, her own mood, other issues related to herself, essentially, but it's usually coming from external sources. For example, people seeking out mortgages from different lending institutions are often coaxed into saying, well, look, if you have the second person working, you can go up to this level of house rather than the one that you're wanting. The family itself is not making decisions about what's best for the family at that point. There's a decision that this house is ideally what the family was looking for, and that a lending institution is giving them advice about what they should be doing as far as not only financial concerns and financial security and risks and things like that, but also what their lifestyle should be like.
Hi, how are you? That's good. I'm just checking. 2 o'clock today. I've got an appointment. Yes, can you change?
Great. 2 o'clock.
Wait. I've been with this company for 20 years now. That, together with another 4 years at university, may seem a little odd to some people to stay with one company for so long, where a lot of my colleagues have moved on to gain other experiences. But I feel myself that stability in employment is worthwhile. You're able to show your capabilities, your reliability. That's what I think management look for.
With my mother and my sisters, they sort of were very angry at what had happened with them in life, and they were very angry at Dad, but unfortunately Dad was, you know, in a different household, and they couldn't get back to him and say all the things they wanted to say, so they found me to be the next best thing. So I'd find myself being violent and throwing things and putting my fist through walls, and I'd find myself not being at home as much. I'd be out doing my own thing. Any time I'd come back was to sleep, and even I'd be lucky to come back then.
The family unit
the mother, father, two and a half kids, and a dog, that traditional family unit just hardly exists anymore. In North America, divorce is at 45 to 60%, depending on the groups. In most Christian schools even, Adventist, Baptist, Methodist, Lutheran schools, almost 35% of the kids come from divorced homes. So you really, when you talk about a family anymore, it's all blended families. Maybe a stepfather, a stepmother, perhaps single parent. It might be the mother or the father that's a single parent.
So you see ridiculous hours being done by individuals, such as 60 and 70 hours. I can't see any reprieve from that at the moment because I personally believe that this is all driven by our perceptions of what we need in this world. And I think those perceptions are driven by advertising and some of the ways that advertising can make us believe that what we're really looking for is the new car, when actually what we're wanting is a fun family life together so that we can go to the beach and spend time in general.
I just find lying in my bed looking up the roof, I'm in the same place every night and nowhere else to go, the same little room that it almost seemed like a prison cell at times. So unfortunately my mattress was an air mattress, so about 3 o'clock every morning I'd have to get up and blow it up again because it had a slow leak, so.
What do I deserve? It might sound one-dimensional, and I suppose it is. Could even be selfish. But what I deserve is money. I'm working for money. We all work for money.
To achieve what you need to achieve, you need to stay longer hours. The corporations are downsizing in the staffing levels, so there's no help there with that expectation of achieving the production. But in terms of an individual then saying to that company, well, no, I don't think that's acceptable, there's also the inherent belief now that there's always someone else who could replace you in your position. So the insecurity that you have in your job then places extra pressure on you to achieve these unrealistic expectations.
She flirts with twilight. When the noise of day dies away.
Oh, the expenses are endless. They see things on TV, they just can't not have them. So you've got to go and buy them the latest games, the latest clothes, the latest shoes. They've got to be connected to the internet. It just seems like it's never going to stop. I mean, you can budget, but you can't plan for these things you don't know about. It's really a bit crazy.
Making a queen of mine. If I could, I
but what you were saying about having children and developing sort of a family life and the fact that you want to maintain your independence, you want to maintain your career perhaps. The emphasis a lot these days is on mothers going back to work rather than caring for the family. But the emphasis is there partly because of, for many families, the financial constraints, because nowadays it's become so expensive. And so constraints on the family are being tightened, if you like, by society. And all the time you're having to fight against what is becoming the norm.
So then what happens to those kids?
I'd find myself in the van smoking a lot and then just having a lot of time to think about what I've done. And unfortunately, that just made me feel worse and worse. I started to see there wasn't a light at the end of the tunnel, really. Became very lonely, almost to the point. To the point where I just felt like I couldn't go on. Basically, I just wanted to top myself off. When it all came down to it at night time, just having no one there and no one to talk to, not having food because all my money would go on drugs. The loneliness is about the hardest thing I've felt dealing with. I'd find myself, even when I was with people, I'd still feel that loneliness.
When the noise of day dies away.
It's probably a little risky to hang in there and wait. Positions don't come readily in the corporate world. You've got to hang in and wait until a position becomes available before you can move up.
And the gentle twilight gives his light, making a queen of night. If I could, I would write a sonnet of the night as a remembrance of your eyes. And if you'd promise not to.
This comes by way of a crisis of some kind. The teenage kids are unruly and they won't behave. Somebody's flunking out of school. One of their kids has got 123 absences or 75 tardies in a class. That's when you have to talk about issues, and that's when families often will make the kinds of corrective changes they need to get everybody back on track. And if parents will just talk in moments of crisis like that, then they can begin to work out some of the directions that are the problems. That doesn't happen often, though. Parents are still distracted with their jobs and their finances and everything, and they just kind of get mad, and then they're not talking any longer. They've done some research on kids who talk to their mothers a lot, and if you can always keep talking to your mother or your father, even in times of terrible crisis, they tend to grow up quite balanced and quite normal, and accept the values their parents have, which is a kind of a thing that parents would like to see them.
Bernie, and we'll all meet 8:30. I'll give Bernie a call then. Thank you. Bye.
I think the divorce rates, or the lack of, let's not even say divorce rates, the lack of satisfaction with relationships in general just mirrors individuals' own lack of satisfaction with a lot of their own pursuits or drives or interests in their life. So it falls into that same thing. Why is it that we get rid of our cars every couple of years? Why is it that we seek an upgrade in the house when we change our managerial position? Well, along those same lines, wouldn't it make sense that we also change our partner when we go up a level in our career, or when we've progressed to a particular stage in our life?
My hopes were just to find happiness again. To have a smile on my face, to not feel this continuous down inside of me that I didn't understand where I could fit in to this world. I found dependency that a lot of people hold on to make themselves feel normal, to make themselves fit in, that we can get sidetracked into these little things that make us feel that we're in control.
An endless to-do list. I never seem to catch up. We're short-staffed. Yes, Julie?
There's so much insecurity in the job place that it's almost like with the routines that we get into, whether it be stuck in traffic, commuting, or working the longer hours, that we're trying to achieve more control, more security, more stability. The distraction of money, it is quite difficult for them to break that pattern. As with any habit that an individual gets into, it takes quite a lot for them to decide they want to change it.
The research shows that it's the stability of the unit that's important, not the configuration of it. So if you're a single parent and you want to make your kids really feel accepted and loved and demonstrate some spiritual values in your family, One parent can do that by the consistency that it models the love that it's trying to teach.
If I were just trying to give them a description of what they should and shouldn't do in that environment, then I could send them away with a book. So they miss the point of coming to the meeting or our sessions, because they're trying to capture the information in the same way as they would in that other workplace environment. Again, there is the lack of communication and realization that a relationship needs to develop to enable those changes to take place if the relationship hasn't been there prior.
Yeah, consistency is almost more important. That's kind of the structure that's important, consistent structure. You can be always strict and loving, and your kids will know how to relate to that because you're consistent. It's when you're permissive one week and then you're terribly strict the next week and then you are angry the next week that kids can't seem to understand how to relate to their family. So there's a sense in which the structure is consistency.
Well, as I see that I was trapped in with my drugs and occasional drinking, which I was dependent on. But I see now I listen to a lot of people talk and get what they're saying, and whatever their problems are, their weaknesses are, I find they have the same sort of dependency, whether it be alcohol or gambling or shopping, mobile phones even, that sort of thing. They don't know when to say enough is enough.
We're an expendable community. We tend to use things and get rid of it quite quickly. So quite often families are divorcing because one person is no longer meeting the needs of the other person. But when you have a look at the closer dynamics in the relationship, one of those people has decided that they deserve something better. We're not talking about needs here, we're talking about wants. And I think that's where people are having difficulty discriminating.
If you want to instill in people values, you have to have long-term relationships with them in those areas where you find meaning. There's research on, which is called resiliency research here in the United States, where you take a sixth grader or a grade school student and you match him with a grandparent for 5 years. And that grandparent or that friend in the community studies with them and sends them birthday cards and asks them how they're doing and takes them out to zoos and make sure their homework's done and checks with the parents to see if everything's going all right, and does this for 6 years. They found that those young people that have had those relationships with people of deep value create young people that are hardly at risk in their lives. They don't take drugs, they don't get into addictive behavior, they don't find themselves in alcoholic patterns or smoking tobacco patterns that are harmful to their health. They find themselves almost reflecting those values of those people they have been mentored by over the years.
I think that's what people need that are in these times of crisis, is just a chance. They need a chance to start off again and work it out. It's a crisis accommodation centre for men that have sort of lost their view on life, found that they've got nowhere to go. They come into the hostel, and the aim of the place is to help them to get them back on their feet. But I'd rather just get out there and see what they're going through. That's what gives me the satisfaction in the job, which is more not part of the job really. Like, I could sit in the office the whole time and just watch them with eagle eyes. They're all searching for happiness. They're all made mistakes, a lot of mistakes in their life, just the same as me. What inspired me is when I was down, it was, like, I didn't need someone to come in and say, I can fix all your problems and I can make it all better. But just that they were willing to talk to me, to relate to what I'm going through.
Most is that without the strong family relationships, and that can be with extended members of the family if the own parents aren't there, or other good friends of the family, without those strong family relationships, I wonder where young individuals are getting their role modelling from. Where do you learn how to socialise with people? Where do you learn how to put up with things that you don't like about the individual because there's this greater good that comes out of that? That's what concerns me most.
To have these people in my life that didn't let me down necessarily, but just led me in the wrong way. I looked up to them in a false sense, hoping that they would be the perfect person to show me the ways of life, show me how to love. But it didn't work out that way.
Well, we found out, for example, that caring, warm, caring families who have relatively good structure create the most positive environment for values to develop. So it's not a permissive family, or it's not a real strict family. It's kind of a loving, structured family that makes values really be believed in a family. And we tried to find out what would make the values stick around the longest. We call it perduring values, kind of a great word nobody uses. How do you make a value perdure? And it's basically because it has to do with families and how much they involve their kids in the life of the family, how much the young people feel involved in decision making in the family, how they see their parents interact, which is pretty crucial in a time when parents don't talk a lot to each other. They don't have time. You know, we've done some research on how many people eat breakfast together, and it's a dismally low figure because everybody's running in the mornings.
What is it when very independent people then get married? You know, what kind of adjustments have to be made? What kind of
This is it. I think you have to have a very understanding relationship at that point and give each other the space that you need.
This is the downside of it. You're right, this is the downside of it.
Because if we're generating a society of people who haven't formed strong attachments, I mean, a general question that I ask is about relationship history, and it astounds me the number of adults that have had few meaningful relationships. And I'm not even talking about intimate relationships, we're just talking about friendships.
You know, the joke of it is that after all these years of commitment to the company, I still don't feel that I have any security.
We're at the day and age of the where it's concentrating on the development of self, and then you come into, again, this scenario of a marriage situation. Okay, these facets of life are necessary, but they can't interrupt my independence.
Well, a lot of them do, though, don't they? You know, the whole marriage thing and the whole, you know, family.
I think having
wider family, you know, your mother throwing in her 3 pence worth. And
if you'd my utopia is not much, really. It's just being happy. Really, that's all I ever want out of life, is that when I'm about to die, when I'm old, if I ever reach old, that I can just smile at life and say I've led a good life. I've done all the things that I've wanted to do.
Hi, honey. How are you? Oh, I'd love to hear from you. Yes. What time will you be home tonight? Oh, yes, well, I'm going to be home about 7:30. So, yes, yeah, I think the kids said they were going to organise their own dinner. What do you think we might have for dinner tonight? Oh, have you got to stop off there on the way home?
The real cost of living is a lot greater because the expectation of what life should provide.
My wife works with her money, more money from me. We could retire a little bit earlier. We both want to travel. We could get out of the rat race and start taking it easy. Hold on. Jeez, I hope it happens soon. Oh, hi, sweetie. How are you going? How's your day been? Yeah. Listen, I'm going to be a little bit late tonight. Sorry about that. What's the chances of us having late dinner? Yeah, just you and I. What time? Well, I probably won't be home till about 8:30, 8:45. Yep, that'd be great. Okay, terrific. All right, darling, see you then. Bye.
More and more nowadays, we're moving into an atmosphere where these things, even in marriage, and the responsibilities in marriage must not get in the way of.
I think you're right. I think where you're heading is that.
Well, I'm thinking that's the downside. It's an extreme.
in no uncertain terms, do you want to suggest that people don't try hard enough anymore? Because I'm sure that's not the case. I'm sure it's not the case that people just don't try with relationships, or just don't work at relationships. Because I think everyone puts in as much as they can into a relationship and wants it to work. I think you have to come back to the reason they're together.
Perhaps
the reason they're together is more important as to the reason they break up, rather than the fact that they don't work at it.
At what point is it right to call it a day? That's the thing, is it?
Yeah.
Because you've got because you have the facility of now the quickie divorce, you know, people say, well, look, you're just not what I want anymore.
Oh, yeah.
So, it's divorce, you know?
Because it's...
I'm no longer happy.
So, the great American ideal, which is great.
Right.
Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And you have... Basically, our culture that we're talking about, you have life, you have liberty, and then it's the pursuit of happiness that consumes everyone.
Why the quickie divorce?
Well, whatever.
Well, so you're saying, we're talking about
the pursuit of happiness.
Move on.
Whatever we're talking about, you know, whether it's, you know, the internet or marriage or relationships or anything, it's the pursuit of happiness. The individual versus the community, all that kind of stuff. It's the pursuit of happiness. You know, everyone feels, I remember my godfather said to me, you know, people nowadays seem to think that they deserve happiness, or that, you know, happiness is their right. And he doesn't remember thinking that that happiness was necessarily a right. It was something, you know, you did kind of strive for. But this kind of you don't make me happy idea.
You see, this is it. What is happiness? I think I would agree that everyone has the right to feel happy, but the state of being happy is often dictated to you by what you perceive as being important in your life.
Right.
So if you don't have those things that you perceive as being important in your life, and where those perceptions come from is a completely different conversation, I know, but if you don't have those things, then you feel that you're not achieving what you should have achieved, you haven't achieved the state of happiness you are aspiring to, and so...
So you
ditch everything and you move on and you try something different. But ultimately, what makes you happy?
Well, I tend to think that happiness
is just
like...
The simplest people can have a happy lifestyle.
Little moments in your life. And the rest of the time you just trundle along and, you know, you pick up as many of the happy moments as you can, you don't?
So if you hang around long enough, you're going to get one or two happy moments.
Yeah, that's really negative.
If you hang around long enough, you're going to get the orange sweet in a packet of donuts. Somewhere along the line, there's this misconception of what commitment is and what commitment isn't. Yes, you cannot escape from the fact that anything to do with commitment, from a job perspective, from your personal, from a professional perspective to anything else, it involves
hard work.
Some sort of work, you know?
Oh yeah, you have to take on board that a relationship's going to be hard work.
Right, right. But when you're with that somebody that you feel comfortable with,
still hard work.
It's still hard work, but it's the sort of work that you want to put an effort into.
Most days.
Most days. Most days. So I guess the reason why people, for me, you know, shy away from long-term relationships these days is because they know somewhere along the line, you know,
it's going to be very difficult.
It's going to be very difficult, and they don't know they've got the stomach for it.
A counselor once told me there's really only three things that trouble families: money, sex, and religion. And in many ways, those three things are pretty much it. Relationships between father and mother, if they're not getting along in terms of their own love relationship, then that shows up in the family and causes tension. If they are so busy with their job and career that they don't have time to build the kinds of relationships that create warmth and acceptance and love, then the kids are the recipients of those kinds of issues. If they have financial difficulty because of both mother and father working, that then creates time problems in the family. So it's not just one, it's kind of a multiplicity of things. And when you think about this generation, this is a generation that has to get things done. And so because we're the baby busters are so product oriented along with their boomer parents, that makes time just not be enough for anything. And all those things that make things important in families, like values and religious life and personal commitments and family interest, all that goes away when there's not enough time to be a family. And a lot of that relates to finances and relationships and religion too. I think every family faces the struggles of trying to make ends meet. I think there must be some rule that you spend everything you make. So if you make more money, you just spend more. There's nobody that really puts it away the way they should. And children are the biggest consumers. You know, they market to teenagers. 13 or 14 year olds is a target audience for a lot of marketers. And so they've got to buy the $120 pair of tennis shoes and have to have the MP3 player that's brand new, you know, and the right earphones and the right shirt. And so parents want to help their kids because they love their kids. It's an interesting syndrome. And I was mentioning there was I read an article in Time by Eric Erickson, the great psychologist who developed the stage theory of identity. And he said that in the United States, especially in the 1850s when the gold rush was around, people would go to Independence, Missouri, which is right in the middle of the United States, and get on a stagecoach and ride for 3 months. And in that moratorium on their life, they would get their life in order. And he's a secular psychologist, and he argued that even great Bible figures used to take time off. 3 years in Arabia, Paul, Jesus 40 days in the wilderness, Moses 80 years in the wilderness, and then you get your life together. And he argued that that's what we don't have in modern culture anymore, a chance to sit back, reflect upon what's really important and of value, and then make the right adjustments in our lives to become living consonantly with those adjustments. And he argued that the time is just not there any longer. And parents can create those moments for their kids by giving them moments to talk, listening, not giving them the pressures of their financial troubles. Often parents will argue about finances and the kids don't understand money, so they think they're destitute and scared to death. And those kinds of issues are never resolved because nobody talks. We did some research on values and found out that if you want to have your kids have values, really good, solid human values or religious values, parents have to be involved in establishing those things. Churches and schools can't do it. In fact, in many ways, it becomes negative to their spiritual life if a church or a school forces them to think about values. But if parents can do it by the way they live and the choices they make, kids stick with those values for a long, long time. So parents, the parental unit, the parental dynamic, the family presence, all those kind of mystical words that make families what they really should be are really important.
I think the ultimate thing for me, or the most helpful thing for me, is being able to maintain a focus on my relationship with my partner, so that if I'm having any difficulties juggling my professional life and my family life, that I can talk to him about it. And that gives him the option of taking steps towards helping me in that. I don't have an over-responsibility towards being a perfect mother or a perfect professional. I think just being more aware of some of the pitfalls of getting into the necessity to have certain material things around me also keeps me on check. But most of all, I have afforded the luxury of being able to say, I only want to work 1 to 2 days a week, or whatever it might be, depending on what's happening at that particular time in my life. I've afforded that luxury because I decided to go through university, because I've decided that I'm not going to jump into huge financial commitments earlier on, and a need to maintain the status of people who are doing the same sorts of things that I'm doing, like working as a clinical psychologist and having young kids. It's a constant thing for my partner and I to talk about these issues, though. We're constantly faced with the challenges of trying to maintain our focus on what's important to us, which is very much a freedom from the necessity to work the long hours. It's the social contact that we have with friends and times of reflection, if you like. That's the most important thing to us, but we're constantly having to remind ourselves of that because that's not the message that we're getting from our environment. Now, the environment is not just advertising an external multi-corporate type of media, but it's also coming from our friends and looking at our friends and thinking about what sort of lifestyles they have.
Didn't let me down necessarily, but just led me in the wrong way. I looked up to them in a false sense, hoping that they would be the perfect person to show me the ways of life, show me how to love. But it didn't work out that way. And people accept me for who I am. And now I've found a reason and a purpose in my life, and he hasn't led me astray. He hasn't put me in the wrong places. He's put me in the right places, somewhere that makes me happy. And I'm learning, and each day, it's not over yet, but each day I'm learning to be more content with myself and understand the emotions that go through my head.
I see the Christian family as a foundational Christian biblical principle, because it is within the family that the most intimate communication and relationship can happen. And as a father, I see my daughter growing up, seeing how mum and dad relate to each other, so that she can see how she can relate when someone argues, when someone disagrees, when there are differences that need to be resolved. And she sees, so that's how a man should treat a woman. That's how a woman should treat a man. I see the concept of family as a fantastic way to enrich the larger community and strengthen the larger community as well.
In the last few decades, we've been taught that you do something if it feels right. And when that has been applied to marriages, people get involved in relationships if it feels right. If another relationship comes along and it feels just as right, well, that's the end of the marriage. And it's kind of a postmodern thing. And perhaps the thing that has really affected our marriages, amongst many other things, is this idea that we don't actually commit to something. We don't rationally go about, taking what our head says, but we just go with our heart. And I think that this has really let us down. You need to have heart and head somewhere in the whole relationship.